The amount of people that are on the slide, this is a large collaborative project that we've been starting to think about and work on in the Hudson for short notes, which is a little different than the projects that we've been working on with the folks from Delaware and Delaware State have been looking at land survey. So a little background about the Hudson, if you're not familiar. It's goes from Lake Tier to the Clouds and the Adirondacks to New York City. It's the ocean. It's a tidal estuary from the Troy Dam south. The project that I'm going to talk about is just north of Hyde Park, which is where that yellow star is. All the project information that I talk about later on, I'll have in direct over it. So, a little background, there's two species of sturgeon that work within the Hudson. One is in the river for the majority of time. This is a short-nosed, much smaller fish. It gets to be about 3 or 4 feet long. The Atlantic sturgeon are anadromous, which move into the ocean. And they get to be 8, 10, 12, 14. I'm not sure if we actually know how big they can get, but much larger fish. And using the side scan with those guys, it's pretty obvious that they're sturgeon. And there's not much else in the river that's that large except for a big tree. So using it for short nose, we're a little hesitant. So a little life history. They're a long-lived species, like most sturgeon. They mature males between 3 and 4, females a little later. Spawning frequency has changed recently. Seems like they spawn more often than we had originally thought, which I think we're finding the same thing with Atlantic sturgeon. They're residents in the estuary, but there's some new evidence that they move between river systems. So the fish tags in the Hudson, they move into the Connecticut River. And they eat stuff in the bottom of the river, insects, crustaceans, and all this. They're amphibious, so they move between saltwater and freshwater constantly throughout their life, which is crazy to me that they can regulate water intake like that. But between seasons, they're moving between brackish water, very salt water, and near harbor in the winter, moving up to spawn in the spring, and they continually do that throughout the year. So that's pretty amazing. And they inhabit rivers all along the East Coast. So they're endangered. They were listed actually before the Endangered Species Act in 1967, and when they put the Endangered Species Act into effect in 1973, they were later listed. So there's been quite a bit of work that's been done on short-nosed in the past. Two main population estimates were done, one in the late 70s, early 80s, and then one in the mid-90s. And you can see by their numbers that there was a dramatic increase in population in a very short amount of time. So for Bain's estimate, 90% of the fish in his population estimate were supposedly adults, which is a little disheartening if there's no little fish. But there was a 400% increase in 17 years. And there's also some independent sampling that happens on the river. Utility surveys, so they're it's paid for by utility companies on the river. They saw a fourfold increase as well. So there's something definitely going on. So National Marine Fisheries Service, who is in charge of endangered species, they are very interested in a new population estimate for short nose for the Hudson River. Hudson River is supposedly one of the largest populations on the coast. We don't really have any new information since the mid-90s, so it's kind of hard for us to know that for sure. Riverwide mark recapture programs are very expensive and very labor intensive. So kind of getting together using some new technologies, we thought maybe we could combine some side scans, some gill netting, and acoustic telemetry to kind of get at a population estimate, and maybe it would be a little less intensive, labor intensive. So this is the side scan. The information on this slide is about all I know about it, so questions about that. I'd have to ask the geologist that we're working with. So when we got together around a table talking about it, we know we can see big 1.5 meter sturgeon. We've done that a lot. But spawning short nose could be a half a meter. And we're concerned that the side scan is not going to actually be able to detect those. So you might actually be able to detect the fish, but know to 100% that it's a short nose. So we decided to do a little project. Staff built these wooden sturgeon, cut them out of plywood, and we made them three different sizes, half a meter, three-quarter of a meter, four sizes, a meter, and then 1.5 meters. And we mounted them on cement blocks on a piece of rebar so we could adjust the height. We lowered them to the bottom in random order and sent the side scan guys out and had them look at the wooden sturgeon. It was right before Christmas, and it was almost like the wooden soldiers were out there. And we did it right near a known overwintering site for a short nose. So we've tagged in the Hudson between the DEC and New York State Thruway Authority almost 100 short nose. And this is a project that, and a manuscript that Rich Pendleton, who's sitting in the back, has been working on. So this is a hotspot analysis, which you ended up not going with, but he was looking at persistence and a general additive model, looking at habitat use in the Hudson. So that's a manuscript that's in prep, so look for that coming out too. But this is the overwintering area that we were working in, and you can see by our detections of fish that it's a very heavily used area. And other researchers, it's not a secret. We didn't find anything. Other researchers already knew that that was there. So these are our locations that we put our wooden sturgeon. And that area that Rich had on that screen is kind of right here. So we were just outside the overwintering area. So here's couple of our technicians lowering them down to the bottom. So the hope was that on the rebar that they would spin when the current started to run. So we've lowered them all down at slack tide, but and when the current started to run, they didn't act like we hoped that they would. So next, a bunch of pictures I'm going to show you are size scan and images. So a lot of these are. He was able to measure them. So with a side scan, you have the unit, almost like shining a flashlight on the bottom of the river. So you get the target, like an image of the target, but you also get a shadow of the target, which is kind of how you know for sure that it's either a fish or something else. So you can see the different measurements that he was able to take using the wooden target and the shadow of the target. So that first one, we were able to do a couple different heights off the bottom. So the first one that I just showed you was a meter off the bottom. This is a little closer to the bottom. This is a half meter. The wooden sturgeon was a much larger target. But you also see that there was a fish that snuck in and got in our study area as well. So that's an actual image of a real short nose in the shadow of the fish. Here's another smaller target, and you can see this shadow. So these are all north-south transects. So you have your west and east, and you can see that the target is actually not the shadow. It was not nose or tail into the current, and it had turned sideways when the current started to move. And that's actually how they stayed when the current was running. So you can see this target is actually perpendicular to the current. So while those guys were side scanning, and we basically they'd say, this is where all the fish are, let's throw some nets here. So the hope was to get an idea of what was there. So what we were seeing on the side scan were they're actually short nose. What sizes of short nose were there. So this area supposedly is for adults that are going to spawn in the spring. So this coming spring, the adults would move north to Pixaki, to Troy, which is in the upper part of the river, and spawn. So these were, should all be spawning adults. So we went out and set a bunch of nets for a very short amount of time, because if you look at the side scan, it, the bottom is just covered with fish. And we caught 33 fish, which in my mind, I thought we were gonna catch thousands of fish. But if you look at this, so these are all fish, just stacked in. This is our net, which is, you know, right on the edge of where the fish are. I think in this net we caught 8 fish. So, you know, obviously we have tons of theories of why we weren't catching the fish. The nets were fishing correctly because they can see the net on the side scan if it's standing up, laying down. The net seemed to be like standing up nicely off the bottom. But for some reason, the fish just weren't getting in the net. And obviously the water was 33 degrees Fahrenheit, you know, but pretty much almost 1 degree. They're probably not moving really fast. But so other people that have gone in net there have caught similar numbers of fish in the same amount of time. So I'm not sure we were doing anything wrong. It's just the method of catching fish might not be the best by using nets. So anyway, I was pretty convinced that we were gonna get slammed with fish, because the first day we got there, slack tide, fish were actually coming to the surface and going up and down, which for unknown reasons, that's, you're in 50, 60 feet of water, it's a lot of swimming for something that's important to get to the surface, in very cold water. So anyway, if we're gonna do this, obviously we have to kind of think about better ways to try to catch the fish. So we're planning to do another little session in the spring, and to change the mounting of the targets so they might swing with the current, so the position of where the pivot point is. And then there's been some talk about using something similar to what's on the screen, but using, make them more 3D instead of a piece of plywood. So that's all I have. Anyone has any questions?